video, we will learn about isoelectric focusing gels, which are used to separate proteins. We know that amino acids have different charges, that is, they can either be positive, negative, or neutral. And they are joined together through a peptide bond to form a peptide or proteins. Proteins are amphoteric in nature as amino acids are amphoteric. As a chameleon can change its color based on the surrounding, an amphoteric molecule can either act as an acid or a base based on the surrounding medium. In simple words, according to the pH of the medium, the charge on the protein will differ. The pH value at which there is no net charge on the protein is known as its isoelectric point. At a pH below the isoelectric point, the proteins carry a net positive charge. And at a pH value above the PI, the protein carries a negative charge. Since proteins have different combinations of positive, negative, and neutrally charged amino acids, they will have different net charges. This overall net charge determines the PI value of the protein. Thus, proteins have different PI values, which means that different proteins will have different pH values at which their net charge will be zero. And this concept is exploited in isoelectric focusing. Isoelectric focusing can be done using agarose gel or acrylamide gel. Agarose gel has a high pore size, but they contain sulfur groups with negative charge, so this may interfere. A 4% preparation of acrylamide gel allows free movement of proteins. Acrylamide gel contains no charge molecules like sulfur, so it is inert and transparent. Thus, acrylamide gel is preferred for IEF. Since the separation is based upon the pH of the protein, here we need to create a pH gradient on the gel. So, to create this pH gradients, we use ampholytes, which are basically complex mixtures of synthetic polyamino polycarboxylic acids. These ampholytes help to create a pH gradient on the gel on which you can separate the molecules based upon the pH. Initially, a 1 to 2 mm thick IEF gel was used by researchers. But the relatively high cost of ampholytes makes this a fairly expensive procedure, especially if you have to run multiple gels. Thus, thin layer gels were introduced, which were only about 0.5 mm thick. And these were prepared using a layer of electrical insulation tape as the spacer between the glass gel plates. So you use the insulation tape as the spacer. Now to prepare this thin layer gel, carrier ampholytes were mixed with riboflavin in the acrylamide solution. This mixture was then poured over glass plates which contained the spacer. Above this, a second glass plate is placed to form the complete gel cassette. Photopolymerization takes place when the gel is placed under bright light. The photopolymerization occurs by decomposition of riboflavin. Riboflavin decomposes to give you free radicals which initiate the polymerization. This process takes around 23 hours, after which the glass plates are removed and the gel is stuck to one of the glass sheet, and you can remove the gel and go on to load your samples. Before application of the sample, a potential difference is applied so that the ampholytes can form a pH gradient between the cathode and the anode. After this, the power is turned on and then the samples are applied.
Unlike other gel matrix that we've studied, here the sample is not applied in the well. The sample is soaked on a filter paper and then the filter paper is placed on the gel matrix. Normally in IEF, the sample is placed in the middle of the gel. A voltage is applied and the sample is allowed to run for around 30 minutes for the sample to move and separate onto the gel matrix. Depending upon the point at which the sample is loaded, the proteins start to migrate. If the protein is initially at a pH range which is below its isoelectric point, if it is below its isoelectric point, then the protein will be positively charged and it will move towards the cathode, which is the negative electrode. As it is moving towards the cathode, the surrounding pH will steadily increase, and as the pH is increasing, the positive charge on the protein will keep on decreasing. There will be a particular point wherein the protein will reach into a state wherein it will not have any charge. That is, it will reach a zwitter ion form. Since now it is not having any charge, it will no longer move towards the cathode and it will acquire a fixed position. Similarly, when proteins that are initially at pH regions which are above the isoelectric point are negatively charged, so these proteins tend to move towards the anode, which is the positive end, and they also reach a point wherein the pH matches the Pi, that is, there is no net charge on the protein, it reaches the zwitter ion form, and so it acquires a fixed position. This allows the separation of the proteins. So now you understand why the proteins are loaded on the center of the wells, so that proteins can move on either of the ends and we can acquire proper separation of both types of proteins. After the gel electrophoresis is performed, the gel must be stained so as to detect the proteins. However, in isoelectric focusing, this staining cannot be done directly because the ampholytes will stain as well and you will get a totally blue gel. Thus, to avoid a completely blue gel, the gel is first washed with a fixing solution which is 10% trichloroacetic acid. This will precipitate the proteins in the gel and it will allow the much smaller ampholytes to be washed out. After you get rid of all the ampholytes, the gel is now ready to be stained using Coomassie Brilliant Blue. After you stain it with Coomassie Brilliant Blue, you use a destainer and then your gel can be visualized. Now, the question is, why go for isoelectric focusing when you can go for SDS page or native page? Now, in SDS page, imagine you are running a protein in its mono, di or triphosphorylated forms. You are running the same protein using isoelectric focusing and using SDS page. Small amounts of phosphate groups which are present in this triphosphorylated form is not going to affect the overall size of the protein. Remember, in SDS page, the proteins separate on the basis of their size. Since these small phosphate groups are not going to affect the size of the molecule, you will only get a single band when you run this protein using SDS page. However, if this same protein is run using isoelectric focusing, a small charge difference will lead to a huge amount of fluctuation in the migration of the proteins. And thus, the same triphosphorylated proteins will give you three bands when run using a IEF gel. Thus, all these information about phosphorylation or acetylation can be obtained about the protein if you are using a isoelectric focusing gel, whereas in SDS page, all this information is hidden. There are many advantages of using isoelectric focusing gel, that is, you can separate proteins with a really high resolution. This method can resolve proteins that are having a pH difference of only 0.01, which is really great. It is really easy to perform. You can even go for native IEF wherein you are not disrupting the native conformation of the protein. Also, the overall charge of the protein is determined by the amino acids. So, if there are two isoenzymes which are differing in just one or two amino acids, and these one or two amino acid changes might affect the overall charge of this protein. Thus, these isoenzymes can also be separated using this method. Also, isoelectric focusing forms a major part, one dimension in 2D page. Along with the advantages, it also has some disadvantages, that it is expensive due to the use of ampholytes. It is a little time consuming and you need to have some trained personnel for this method.
If this video was helpful to you, then please like this video, share it with your friends, subscribe to my channel, and don't forget to leave us your valuable comments. Thank you.